Welcome back to Kopitiam Council. And Adi, there's a news from our neighbor recently that they are going to give more incentive to their medical staff, more importantly, their nurses, of around $2,000 so that they can retain all this talent in the in their country because they're having a shortage of not just doctors, but apparently, and more importantly, nurses. So how do you see this development happening just across Johor Strait?
Singapore, they have themselves their own issue with skilled labor. It's definitely going to attract more people from Malaysia or even Sabah itself. Let's go back to Sabah, because when it comes to job opportunities for Sabahans, what better way would it be to then to find prospects in somewhere that you can find decent employment? Of course, it's somewhere that's offering you incentives to move there. So you could see some kind of migration from Johor that's nearby, nurses who are willing to uproot their lives and move to another country, different environment, which is still quite similar to home, but you know, a bit more prosperous, a bit more more prospects for development. Like, I've had a few friends who's actually moved to Singapore to be trained as nurses, to enter that kind of field, just because the prospects are much better over there compared to over here. And this ties into the wider idea of that we are suffering a huge brain drain issue. A lot of our labor is being pulled out into different directions now. Of first, we have people moving away from Sabah to Kuala Lumpur. And I can foresee that it's going to be pulled in different directions now that Sarawak is slowly propping up its infrastructure, its own economy, developing itself to become a very, very viable destination to work in. So I would see a lot of young Sabahans moving there. And then now with Nusantara in Kalimantan, capital city, which is definitely going to require a lot of industries there to make sure that it becomes a very functional, a very high quality of life city, then we're definitely going to see more Sabahans also being pulled in that kind of direction, pulled to Kalimantan to work there, which is ironic because we've always had this perception that a lot of Indonesians like to come to Sabah to work. The reverse might happen, and it's a twist of irony. Or even, if I'm going to be a bit more bold to say, you could see more young Sabahans doing businesses, working in southern Philippines, now that he has stabilized under the autonomous government. There hasn't been issues of kidnappings or piracy that is hugely high profile in the last few years. So brain drain, this ties into a wider idea of brain drain itself, not just for Malaysia as a country, but Sabah as well. I think Sabah is hit one of the worst when it comes to brain drain here. And in a way, the brain drain is much more impactful for people in Borneo compared to people in Semenanjung, because people in Semenanjung, if they move from their state down, they can move to Kuala Lumpur, they can easily move back up to their home state. While Sabah, we have to take a very expensive flight back and forth, which makes it difficult to, you know, retain that local sense of belonging or coming back home or coming back to transfer whatever skills you picked up over back here. So Singapore priming itself to potentially take more of our people away and further exacerbating the whole brain drain issue that we have.
Yeah, I think we talk about Sabah, how Sabah should position itself as more renowned in certain industries. Otherwise, the failure for Sabah to focus on certain industry at its forte, it's going to be the death of Sabah. And we can see this even more importantly out just our neighboring state, Sarawak, because they now started showing already in certain industries that they can really hold on to and become a dominant player in respective industry. So, I mean, Singapore is on their own level with their economy and everything. So, put Singapore aside, let's talk about like states like Sarawak or even Indonesia now that come into the mix. That like you said, ironically, last time we said also there's always Indonesian immigrants that wants to look for a job in Sabah or Malaysia, but now it's the other way around. How the table has turned, and for IKN that's gonna be launched this year end, it's gonna be a mark of modern brand, as also CIQ in part of Tawau already completed. So now that it's almost seamlessly migration between Sabah and Kalimantan Timur gonna happen, definitely gonna happen. So with the hype up, with how Indonesia gonna invest millions of billions of US dollars to create Nusantara, it's gonna excite not just Sabahan, I think Sarawakian as well. So the government see, maybe Sarawak sees, that they need to hold on to certain industry, otherwise everything will be taken over by either Indonesia or Semenanjung, as you said, and Singapore. So Sabah, as a government, we need to double down on certain industries that we think we can be a pillar of Sabah economic growth. Otherwise, it's going to be a losing battle, a battle that we are already losing even before we enter it. So that's going to be... And one contributor to that is Brendan. Recently, a PISA ranking as a whole, Malaysia, it was not really great for us. But can you imagine on the level of each respective state in Malaysia, and more importantly in Sabah? I don't think it's gonna be much better anyway. So STEM, focusing on STEM, science, technology, and maths, it's gonna be key to propel us into a industry revolution 4.0, because this is where the generalization, no longer specification of skill sets needed. Anything that, you know, if you want to write a novel now, you can do it in 5 minutes using AI right now. So what are the skill sets that we need to equip our youth so that they can be more competitive in the future? So we need to talk about more open discussion within a lot of shareholders, how TVET can empower our youth. So this is one of the way. I mean, I implored the government to empower TVET, but I think local government should pay more attention to this, because these are the direct centers like IKBN, where the institute, they can develop something like this. Polytechnic as well. These are very famous TVET that we have. So why don't we empower more shifting towards only, you know, after you've done your SPM, which university you're going to? I think that conversation needs to be shift. This Hari Raya, we need to, instead of asking like, hey, when are you getting married, or are you going to have another newborn, instead ask for, are you going for a TVET instead of university, maybe? So that's kind of discussion should be asked, and the government should play a bigger role in moving people's mindset towards TVET, because I don't know about your generation, ID, but for my generations, some TVET is really looked down upon, and that's not something really reflect the reality of it. Don't you agree?
Yeah, I think TVET definitely is the way to go, and I think there have been movements to actually jumpstart and try to stimulate the whole TVET ecosystem. And I think with the launching of the recent Human Capital Development Blueprint last year by JPSM, it is definitely a priority. I think I've seen that the Sabah State Government is trying to shift towards. Now, an issue here as well is to find out, okay, once you set up these institutions or you enhance the existing institutions, is to provide that pathway for them to actually find employment. And that takes a lot of discussions with stakeholders such as businesses, commercial entities, to actually employ or to help set up businesses that are related to TVET-related skills or vocational skills. And I think there is a huge proof of concept that this kind of pathway is very viable in terms of career success and career development. Because in the last year, or even the last 2 years, every time I see an award being given to, let's say, a teacher or a student, a lot of the times, it's not given to, like, students in, let's say, UITM or UMS. A lot of the times, it's places like College Vocational Keningau, which has won, you know, some of the teachers there have won numerous awards, the international awards, recognizing their contributions in innovating class syllabus or teaching them, or even like other in other aspects as well. So there's a lot of accolades that's been given to people in these kinds of institutions, individuals in these kinds of institutions. So that means there is a clear display of talent and a proof of concept that this is a very prospective pathway for a lot of young Sabahans to take. Now, it's trying to develop the business for the commercial ecosystem that they can tap into, where they can make use of what they have gathered or what they have learned through these institutions, like setting up their own place to actually conduct their own trade. Like you compare it to, let's say, Australia, where you have that, you know, whole stereotype of tradesmen who do bring on their own apprentices to actually teach them all these harder skills to actually create their own, you know, businesses such as plumbing businesses, electricians, construction, like small construction. So now we need to find, you know, to develop that kind of business market for in Sabah so that it ensures that people are able to find quick employment, at the same time passing on skills and knowledge to people who don't want to see pursue an academic future, but a future that is a bit more technical and more vocational. So it's still a long way to go for me. It's because it does take a lot of time. But we've seen a lot of, like, the last few batches of people who did come from them are definitely people of talent and substance. Now, it's just trying to make sure that they are able not to be funneled into, let's say, whatever the state thinks is correct, but, you know, given funneling them into a pathway where they can maximize their potential and their skills. So it's the ecosystem itself that comes after the vocational institutions that are very important right now to set up more incentives to get into that kind of business, such as grants, or even giving incentives to businesses to hire more people from these kinds of places.
Yeah, also in the same week, MOH also announced that doctors will be paid for doing locum, 80 ringgit per hour, and that's a right step into retaining our doctors in private public sector. But I think this is rather than something that very minimal being done by the ministry, because this is long overdue, that been pushed by the doctors so that the government can do, but only been done now. It shows that there's a lot of resistance on how to reform our medical care or healthcare in that matter for a better way. Because as you know, even the numbers, if you compare to 2,000 Sing dollar incentive towards 80 ringgit per hour, it's something very, like, you know, it's like almost muted the ministry effort into empowering our medical staff. So even though policy is important, but also the fundamentals, we talk about fundamentals of a nation just now, but the fundamentals of the state itself also very important to play a role in what you said, to facilitate the role that it should play as a state, because it's a vicious cycle. Because if companies doesn't or cannot operate in our state of Sabah, it cannot generate economic benefit for its ripple effect. So issues like water shortages or electricity's blackouts, these are very important things. And businesses, when they make decisions, they look at these things. And if the state is still struggling on how to tackle these basic necessities, as we call, especially in the advanced country, then how are we going to talk about taking advantage of Industry Revolution 4.0? How are we going to talk about AI if suddenly our computer shut down? That's not gonna happen, isn't it? So this, especially the HGG administration, should look into, and more robust, if we call for Anwar something robust approach, then if we even should be demanding even more robust from Sabah state government, so that and simply because we are in a dire need for this kind of thing, and any assurance from the chief minister should be welcome any time. I think you are muted, Adi.
Sorry. I was saying that with the whole brain drain situation, I think the government is making some attempts to counteract the forces of a lot of Sabahans moving outside the state by bringing in more foreigners or people outside Sabah to come into working here through the Sabah My Second Home program, which means that if you are purchasing property up to 600,000 ringgit, you are eligible to be part of this program. As to what it means, like the benefits that you get, I'm still not too sure. We have to wait for an announcement from the state minister, the state ministries, such as the tourism ministry and the chief minister himself. So this would be a positive step when it comes to bringing more skilled foreigners, skilled labor outside Sabah to bring in what they have to the table. But at the same time, it would help stimulate the property market here as well. How far it may stimulate it, I'm not too sure, considering that a lot of places in Kota Kinabalu still experiences a housing bubble, where a lot of property here is way, way more expensive than even some of the more upmarket places in Kuala Lumpur. So I don't know how that will play out into stabilizing market prices for property here in Sabah, but it does bring some kind of diversity from outside of Sabah to the state through skilled labor from individuals outside. So it's, you know, having more people outside come in terms of diversity is always great. However, it also needs to be said that if we are putting this much priorities for people outside Sabah, we need to see an equal concerted effort for people who are trying to purchase property in Sabah as well. So maybe there's mixed messaging there. Maybe the government really is trying to tackle the whole housing markets here in Sabah. But as far as I know, it does has elicit some kind of mixed reception from locals thinking that why are these people outside Sabah that are paying 600,000 to buy property here getting so much benefits, getting some kind of benefit, while people in Sabah itself can barely find a house in places in commercial centers such as Kota Kinabalu itself. So maybe there's something in the works that is going to be announced that would surprise us. But so far, at least there's something there. But how I will assess it, I will still have to wait and see how it plays out. You're muted as well.
Oh, I made the same mistake as you did. Okay. If the Sabah Second Home program is to be true, because 600,000, I think ID for foreigners is quite low, and they will be very happy to buy, purchase property that low. I think this is another attempt by the government to put a band-aid on something that needs a reform of a policy. And I think the developers are pushing for this because they want their unsold house to be sold as soon as possible. So this is politicians rubbing shoulders with business people, and then they come up with in my opinion, idiotic policy like this. I mean, I'm not against Sabah as a second home program, for example, but the details, the devil's in the details, and why capping it like minimum 600,000. I mean, any almost anyone in middle income in Sabah can buy that. Why are you putting this on foreigners to have? So I think maybe they should follow. I think if I'm not mistaken, Malaysia Second Home, I think it was 2 million, I guess, 2 million property. If you know, start with property, and there should be a subsequent requirement as well in terms of cash in hand or whatever that should be a part of the requirement. So yeah, I think I'm quite worried if this amount is true, but let's see if it's to be the case. I think that's it for Brendan that we can talk about. If there's anything that you wanna say as a conclusion for our episode this week, Adi.
I think there's a lot in the pipeline in the works. Is like I said in the first episode, when it comes to this episode's out this week, as you're listening, we'll be having the Congress Economy Bumiputra, which is will be Anwar Ibrahim's first one. So I'm expecting to see some kind of huge decisive measure or something radical to be announced. And we can be very sure for a lot of our listeners that once it is, definitely Kuriam Council will take a look into what is being developed there, and we shall see if it is something worth our time. Was it worth the Prime Minister's time to actually make this a huge thing, a very huge affair? And will we see policies or initiatives that would be conducive to addressing what we've mentioned today, which is the depreciation of ringgit or even brain drain and upskilling of our local talents, or finding ways to incentivize foreigners to come into Malaysia, at the same time making sure that our own welfare is ensured. So a lot of things that are exciting to look at.
Yeah, as exciting as our this episode as well, because we're gonna, this is our I think our third episode in 3 weeks, so I think that's something to be something good to have as we try to commit on every Monday, so that you can listen to KopiTM Council wherever you like, on Spotify or Apple Podcast. So with that saying, this is it for this week. We look forward to talk about more topics, but whether it's outside Malaysia, Malaysia or Sabah, for example, and catch you on in the next episode. Goodbye for now.
Goodbye.